Well, hey, everyone. Welcome to Framework Leadership, a podcast about principles and ideas you can use today to take your leadership to the next level. We're now exclusively a part of the SEU Podcast Network. I'm your host, Ken Engel, president of Southeastern University.
And I'm your co-host, Michael Steiner, SEU chief of staff.
And wow, today our guest for today's show, Peter Haas. Peter is author, leader, pastor of Substance Church in Minnesota. He also serves on the lead team of ARC. So we're excited to be able to have a conversation today.
Yeah, honored to be here. Thank you, guys.
It is a privilege.
Such a blessing.
And you know, I want to open up our conversation by discussing your story and how you've gotten to where you are now. You actually came to know the Lord while you were a DJ at a nightclub, yep. Which is amazing to me.
Some people give their lives to Christ in churches, yes. And others of us are just so weird.
Oh no, this is great. So tell us about that time in your life and how your calling, you know, completely transformed everything.
Yeah, well, you know, I didn't really grow up in church. In fact, you know, my dad was a doctor and very much kind of a skeptic. Mm. And so, like, I didn't really understand anything about church, but I had a Christian friend that was always trying to lead me to Christ, and I always thought that's kind of weird, you know, mm-hmm. like, no thanks. And yet, you know how it is. Life is designed to lead to God. Eventually, you're going to have enough pain enough difficulty, and you're going to ask deeper questions. And I knew the whole universe could not have spontaneously arrived out of nothing, even as a non-Christian. That just seemed implausible, and it just organized itself. So I knew, in fact, I asked my girlfriend, we were looking at the stars one night, and I was like, man, there's just no way with this spontaneously arrived out of nothing. And here we are, and there's snowflakes and PlayStations, and, you know, like, it didn't make, and I'm like, and she knew I was searching, and she goes, well, have you ever just asked God to reveal himself to you? And I'm like, what do you mean? Yeah. That's weird. Yeah. And I'm like, nah.
Like a genie?
I'm not open, right? And then, you know, again, tragedy struck. My girlfriend found her father after he had committed suicide. And it was just it was really a terrible, terrible thing for her to go through that. And I saw how painful it was. And then that same week, my friend died in a car accident, tragically. And I started asking deeper questions. What's the meaning of life? And I literally was working as an electronic dance music turntablist. So I was a music producer, but then I would work at these clubs on the weekend. And I was just at the club, depressed out of my mind, thinking, I hate life. Like, I don't get it at all. And in my mind, I thought, you know what? Ask God to reveal himself to you. And so I literally prayed in the nightclub, God, if you are real, then you should be powerful enough to show me what religion is the right religion. Just make it clear. Just give me a sign, lightning bolts across the sky, Islam, Buddhism, none of the above. Yeah. Just make it clear, right? Yeah. And I snapped out of this prayer, and I'm thinking, wow, I must really be depressed. I'm praying. And I thought, my next thought was, I just need a smoke break. And so then I handed off the turntables to my assistant, walked down from the second story of the club, crossed the dance floor. I was leaving the club, and a guy grabbed me by the arm and said, dude, I know this is... He basically said, dude, I know this is weird, but I feel like I'm supposed to tell you Jesus has a plan for your life and he wants you to follow him.
Wow.
Like 30 seconds after I prayed this prayer.
In the club. You hadn't left the club.
Yes. And in my mind, I was kind of freaking out. Like, oh no, Jesus showed up at my nightclub. And now I have to do whatever the guy says. I was scared. I mean, I literally had... like a horror movie. I was scared. Mm-hmm. I was sweating.
Yeah.
And I grabbed him and I'm like, what did you say? And he repeated it again, except a little more awkwardly. And then I'm like, tell me what I'm supposed to do. And what was funny was, is I think he, in his mind, he was thinking I was angry.
Yeah.
But in reality, I was scared because I'd never experienced a prayer answered like that fast, that quickly. And I'm like, tell me what I'm supposed to do. And he kind of fumbled like, pray, I guess. Yeah. And he led me to Christ right there in the club. And I literally went to church with that guy the next day.
Wow.
And that was it.
Wow.
Which was the weirdest entrance into Christianity. But because I didn't grow up in church, I had endless questions for him about church. Why do churches put carpet on their stages? Why do churches have, why do they only use white lights? Why do they, you know, why do people lift their hands? Why do people, you know, like infinite curiosity, but So when I became a pastor, it kind of almost became this obsession of, I know how confusing it is walking into church culture, and Christians are not even aware of church culture right. anymore, mm-hmm. because right. you just adapt to it. It's it's normal for us to do X, Y, and Z, but you know, there's people out there who honestly don't understand anything. Mm-hmm. And so that's why when we planted our church, we thought, let's plant a church with a little bit of a weird name and that reaches unchurched people, and let's just try to think about it through their lens. And so we always tell our people, you'll never understand why we do what we do on a Sunday morning unless you regularly invite your unchurched neighbor. Because you just won't see things the same way. Like when you invite your unchurched neighbor to church, the lyrics of the song all of a sudden become, I mean, you think
right,
about
they matter,
it. Yeah, all the cliches,
right.
they suddenly matter. You feel like you have to contextualize it. And so our goal is, if we can contextualize more and more and more and more of it before they even step foot in the church, then, you know, we're just decreasing that culture barrier. Right. Mm-hmm. You know, so again, we're not watering down the truth. We're just crossing the culture gap.
Right. So, I mean, walk us through that jump, though, from accepting the Lord in your life into realizing, okay, I'm called to full-time ministry to be a pastor. I mean, that's, you know,
I got kind of suckered into ministry early because my story was so dramatic, obviously. Yeah. You know, it's like a Saul to Paul kind of conversion. Right. Almost within weeks of me going to churches, I would walk into a church and people would be like, oh, you're that DJ that got saved. You're like, you're like the... Here, can you share your testimony?
Right.
And it was almost like I got dragged onto platforms.
Wow.
Like from the very beginning.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then I'd be like, I don't know any Bible verses. Yeah. And they'd be like, you don't need any. I'll share the Bible verses. You share the testimony.
Yeah.
And then it was almost like I got suckered into being a youth evangelist.
There we go. Yeah.
Almost out of the gate.
Right, for sure. And EDM, like you
probably,
speak the whole,
probably dysfunctionally.
Yeah.
But I mean, believe it or not, I became a youth pastor probably only a couple of years later, and a senior pastor only a year or two after that.
Wow.
So in some ways, I was kind of like, I mean, I fell down the Slippery Creek bank into full-time ministry very quickly, probably dysfunctionally fast.
What would you say were in that first time, you know, you're encountering the faith for the first time, you're talking about like, okay, these things don't make sense, then you step into full-time ministry. What are like, if there was a couple things that you're like, okay, right off the bat, this didn't make sense, this didn't make sense, this didn't make sense in how we do church ministry?
Oh, man. There was a lot of it, but I didn't question it skeptically because in my mind, I had kind of resolved in my head, I'm so screwed up. Who am I to critique Christians?
Sure, right. Sure.
If Jesus was willing to come to my nightclub, so to speak, answer my prayer, then I owe it to him to indulge the strangeness of the church.
Yeah.
And so I didn't question it up front. I ingested it and processed it. It wasn't until I became a lead pastor and I started asking the question, why do we do church like this? Right. Why do we do offerings where we do them?
Yeah.
Why do we do these types of Christmas things? Why do we? And I started actually, and then when I finally had permission to start changing it, obviously I would get persecuted from our church members because people would be like, what are you doing? What are you doing? Like you would have, like our church, that the first church that I took over, it was almost a little hyper-charismatic. They did probably 9 songs a Sunday, right? I mean, it was a long worship set. So like by the time, I'm the lead pastor and I'm like, I wouldn't invite my friends here. I'm exhausted by the time I even get up to preach, you know, so many worship songs. Well, when I changed the worship set from 9 songs to 7, you would have thought I like converted to Islam,
right.
You know,
right.
Yeah, it was
exactly.
Just like, but you know, so then I had to understand, oh, this is a political entity that has traditions, some of which have just been acquired over time. And I just, you know, I realized I have to be slow with even how I help people transition. And actually, that's part of the reason why I planted is I realized that the church that I'd taken over, it had, you know, it had 80 acres or 75 acres paid off. But I'm too progressive for the church, which is why I planted 17 years ago our church so that I could kind of build it from scratch. But by that point, it was because I didn't want to contend with people spiritualizing the church service. Mm-hmm. Like a lot of people would say, oh, I see you're not a biblical church because you don't do expository preaching. Okay. Or I see you're not. Everybody has their thing where if you don't do 30 minutes of altar ministry, 30 minutes of, or if social justice conversation, if you don't, you know, everybody has these like litmus tests for what they see as a true biblical church. And again, we all have preferences, right?
Yeah.
But we spiritualize those preferences where we start saying, oh, that's a biblical church. And so those are the things that I've always tried to steer clear of. But our church now has so many unchurched people that we don't really have to deal with.
Right.
I call them religiously transmitted diseases.
That's so good.
You know, because we don't get transfer growth.
Yes. Right.
Most of these people are kind of like me. They're just kind of accepting a new reality as it's presented to them, and hopefully we're not starting our own weird traditions, which we are, you know.
Yeah. Oh, man, I would have loved to. Fascinating to be a part of your church as you begin to lead. And that's a question I want to ask about stewardship of your transformation.
Yeah.
So, man, now you are being transformed, and God is changing the trajectory of your life and placing really this calling upon you. So how did you approach that? And the word stewardship, I don't know what came into your mind. But what did you begin to do so that you could bring your best self now to this transformational moment?
Totally. Let me set it up with a simple story. A while ago, I heard of a guy who was an art collector, and he would just buy like little art, religious art.
Yeah.
That he would just get at garage sales and things like that. And it wasn't an impressive collection, but he had this paperweight that somebody gave him. And he happened to host a party at his house. And one of his guests at this party happened to be the curator of like one of the big art institutes in New York. And this guy came to the house and he was showing off his unimpressive collection of really lame art to this curator who's around, you know, billion-dollar Monets and Picassos. Yeah. And all of a sudden, this curator looks at the paperweight on his coffee table and says, "What's this? This is really interesting." And he's like, "Oh, that old thing? Yeah, a priest bought it at a garage sale, gave it to me, thought I might like it, and I use it as a paperweight." And the guy was like, I think this is a little older than you think it is." And he goes, "Would you mind if I took it into the lab at my art laboratory and just had my guys look at it?" And he's like, "No, I don't care. Take it." The guy takes it in, and it turned out to be a work of art from the guy mentored by Donatello. So this was like, and ended up being a priceless lost artifact that was worth tens of millions of dollars.
Wow.
And I kept thinking about the odds of this guy collecting it and inviting that curator over to his house. Now, if it had not been for that curator, this guy would still be using it as a paperweight.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
I think that everybody has gifts in their lives that they think are paperweights.
Wow.
That are actually priceless works of art. And then there's other things in our lives that we think are impressive, but are actually pieces of junk, right?
Yeah.
And I think every leader out there has a certain set of skills, but you're discerning what's really of value. And I always say you got to get around curators who can really help you figure out what is of value and what is
not
a distraction. Yeah. And so what I did early on was I found a leader who was living out my dreams, and I just made the decision to earn the right to be around them. Mm-hmm. And so I'm always telling young leaders, what are your dreams? Who's living out your dreams? And what are you doing to earn the right to be around those leaders? Mm-hmm. And that if you can identify the answer to those three questions, and the third one is a little counterintuitive because it's earn the right to be around those leaders. I'm like, most mentors who are great mentors are too busy to mentor.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so you got to go make it easy for them getting around them. And if that means, so like I have like a mentoring budget, I'll fly to get mentored by people.
Wow.
And if that's what it takes for me to get mentored, but I got to get around a curator who can say, okay, Peter, here's even a better way to lead your church than you currently do it.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? And so if I have to fly to a John Maxwell event to hang out with John Maxwell, if I have to, you know what I mean? Like, I'm going
to
do whatever.
Shout out to John Maxwell. We heard you listen to this podcast. We just want to plug to you right here if you're listening to it.
We love you, John. Wink to you. Love us, Matt. We love you. No, but for real, though, I went and I found a really dynamic church, and I just planted myself in it.
Mm.
for it, and it left myself planted there for a painfully long time until those leaders can sculpt me.
Yeah.
And curate me.
Yeah.
That's so good.
And, you know, honestly, call out the invaluable treasure in my life. And I think a lot of people, they leave before the curator has time to be honest with them.
No, that's powerful. And that's a value, actually, that we have here at SCU. You know, we're always talking about how do we build a map to a place we've never been before.
Yes.
And that is basically finding someone who's there.
Yep.
And taking the opportunity to get into the presence of that person that is at the place you want to be, mm-hmm. and then begin to learn and to take it in, to soak in, and that just begins that process of helping you build that map to mm-hmm. get to that place that you know you need to be.
Yep.
And grow. So that's so important. I want to, you know, we've faced a major pandemic over the last couple of years, and there's no doubt that the pandemic is really changing how churches do life, do ministry.
Yep.
But I can imagine having a church in Minnesota during this past year that has had unique challenges with a lot of different issues that has been faced. So how have you and your team led, especially during these last couple of years?
Oh, man. Well, I mean, just to give you a sense of context, so our downtown campus is a 130-year-old building built by Civil War contemporaries.
Wow.
And it was only six blocks north of where George Floyd died.
Hmm.
And you have to understand it. I mean, it was on our doorstep.
Mm.
Like the events that transpired. I mean, we had people around our building even having to protect it in the midst of it. But it also became ground zero to some of the greatest outreach in our church's history. Yeah. I mean, we gave away, you know, like 8 million pounds of food this last year from that location. And, you know, but we had to be intentional about, hey, right now is not the time to make a point. It's the time to make a difference.
Sure. Yeah, that's good.
And every single time our church members, because we were getting it from both sides, you have the extreme 20%ers on both sides. If you don't, from this angle, if you don't take a stand, and then the other side saying, if you don't take a stand and say these things.
Right.
And I'm like, you know what? Let's not make a point. Let's make a difference. Yeah. This is like, at some point, we have to engage our culture differently. And I'm like, you need to live in the middle and just sacrifice for people, because at the end of the day, people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care, as the old saying goes. And so we just had to love with action instead of words. And so we just turned our entire church into like outreach church this last year. Our church has always been traditionally good at small groups. As great as our church services might be and as flashy as they might be, we're a church where we've always said church doesn't start until the service is over. We're a small group church. And so for us to pivot to Zoom home groups we've always engaged our people that way. And so, to be honest, that wasn't even the hardest part. The hardest part was watching all churches nationally go through hardship. In some ways, I knew our church was going to actually thrive in the middle of it. But for me, it was watching all these pastors go into despair. And all these pastors who had kind of built maybe their churches with wrong motives and, you know, built them for numbers or built them for all these things that maybe at the end of the day aren't the main thing.
Right, right.
And in some ways, I almost feel like God used it as like a healthy pruning to make sure all of us as leaders are in it for the right reasons.
Wow.
No, you know, to love people. Because let's be honest, loving people is messy. Ideologically imparting worldview, it's messy. Yeah. And this last 2 years, I mean, it was messy. It was a hard time to be a leader. And I think so in some ways, I'm actually kind of, it's actually a great time to learn leadership because it's, you know, it's not easy, and that's good.
Well, and I love about it is you talked a little bit ago, and even before we were talking about how much like you wanted to plant something different, right? There's things you wanted to change, you wanted to see different. How much were those things that you saw different? How much did they pay off when these changes come? I mean, you talked about small group as one key, but what are some of the other things you guys did that really you saw it?
This will be kind of counterintuitive. So, because I, being a music producer, the moment I saw, I went to a really dynamic worship leading church that had a lot of, you know, well-known worship leaders, and I immediately kind of nerded out on the music producing and the LED walls and you know, the flash, right? Yep. Well, you know, I'm in these churches that are some of the best in the world at compelling services, tear-jerking sermons. But then my mentor had a moral failure. And I remember thinking, how could they be in the middle of the greatest church service on planet Earth and still do this? And it actually caused me to search my soul, because at the time, it wasn't even so much that I felt betrayed by my mentor. Actually, I felt convicted because there were undealt with issues in my own life. Mm. And I came to James 5:16, confess your sin to one another and pray for each other so that you may be healed.
Yeah. Wow.
Biblical healing is preceded by confession of sin, not by attendance of church services.
Wow.
And I know that sounds kind of counterintuitive for a guy who is trained to put on the greatest church service ever, but from that point on, I was like, you know what? If I can just get my church to funnel them into relationships and intimacy where they could confess their deepest, darkest secret, then I know that I'm going to start succeeding as a pastor in bringing about biblical healing. And so that became my obsession, is how do I use church services to funnel people into organic fellowship? And I found a study a while ago that showed three of the top predictors of spiritual growth are how many friends you have, Christian friends you have, at any given moment. People that have 4 to 7 friends are likely to serve Christ over the long haul. People with less than 4 to 7 friends at any given moment have high risk of walking away from Christ. Ownership in a weekly ministry is the second biggest predictor. Yeah. People that have a weekly ministry in a local church rate themselves 7 times happier than people who do not.
Mm. Wow.
And then the third biggest predictor is exposure to a leader who is always inviting them. In other words, most discipleship is not taught. We're invited into maturity. Most people don't jump into deeper maturity on their own. They're invited. I didn't fast on my own. I heard like a dozen sermons on fasting. Did I ever do it? Of course not. Because I like food, right?
Right.
Same with generosity. I needed to be invited into it. And so a church culture, so like we built our church on those values of we want to make it impossible to attend our services for longer than 3 months without finding 4 to 7 friends.
Wow.
A ministry and exposure to a leader who invites them into deeper levels of maturity. And so when the pandemic hit, we were already kind of engaging our people through organic church, not through church services. So when you shut down the church service, our church was still alive because it was all small groups. Everybody had their friends, their ownership, their ministry had to pivot to help us do small groups across the city, outreach across the city. But that was a small transition for us. So in some ways, it was the churches where all they are is a church service. Now, that was traumatic. And so in some ways, it was actually, we had to pivot to helping other churches rediscover organic church again.
What did that look like? What were some of the things you guys did in that?
Well, first off, it was like, okay, it was helping churches learn how to do like Zoom-oriented small groups.
Got it.
And so, like, for example, we basically taught, like, helped churches across the United States. We right when the pandemic hit, we filmed like 17 different videos to help pastors, first off, learn how to stream, learn how to turn everyone into a Facebook missionary, Instagram missionary, Snapchat missionary, Twitter, TikTok missionary. Here's how each of those like we talk about disciples of all nations. Well, there's a nationality called Instagram. It's now a new planet. I call it like planet Twitter, planet TikTok. Yeah. There's people that live on that planet and we have to go engage them. And that means taking content. Mm-hmm. How do you take content that reaches that people group?
Right.
And so it was almost like, how do we rethink everything that we do into each of these people group. Let me teach you how to be a missionary. Mm, yeah. So here's how you reach people on Facebook with our church services, streaming our services. Here's how you engage visitors in the chat room. Here's how you, those types of things. So it was more like how to rethink church. Yeah. This is the new church foyer. How do you do it? Mm-hmm. And so just teaching churches how to do that. There were a lot of churches that were just not technologically ready, which... Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, unfortunately, I think God is using the pandemic to get us out there again.
Mm-hmm. And you feel like the changes are going to stay this way?
Well, there is a lot of churches that are like, they're just wanting to go back to church service-driven Christianity. Mm. And unfortunately, you know, and I can see a lot of pastors doing that. Mm-hmm. But for us, we're kind of like, no, from the pandemic on, we are no longer a physical church with a digital presence. We are a digital church with physical locations.
Wow.
How do we think differently like that? Like, how do you think about sermons differently? How do you think about packaging content differently?
Yeah.
All of that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All of that.
Yeah. And part of that is, honestly, you're going to have to get some of those natives, right, of those planets and unleash them and say, and go to them. Don't.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I'm so telling you. I actually think social media ministry is the new, it's kind of like in, you know, the 90s, it was all about, you know, youth pastors, and the 2000s, it was about worship pastors and campus pastors, and you know, then media, and then social media. Now it's gonna keep shifting. I mean, we're gonna need, like, I keep thinking, we're gonna need social media staff for. I mean, like right now, like video editing, teaching pastors is kind of like my biggest obsession, is making sure everyone on our staff knows basic video editing.
Yeah,
and
that's good.
Things like that, because you just I don't know, I don't even know how you can pastor people without understanding.
Yeah,
right. If you're not willing to record some stuff, pop it on Instagram, pop it on Facebook. I mean, even low quality stuff, but still stuff. Yeah, you got to know how to that rhythm.
The reason why I think the church lost a lot of ground this last year is because CNN and Fox are discipling our people better than the church is.
Right.
And so as a result, we're losing ground to these semi-Christian worldviews in both that are packaged through these political filters. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then we wonder why we have hardship. Well, I think it's because we as the church have not engaged culture well enough.
That's so good. Huge. As we talk about, you know, leadership and growing and developing in leadership, if we dig into personality types, you know, and there's all kinds of personality tests, things like that, the Enneagram, you know, all of that. You talk about in your books that you write, and you're an amazing writer.
Thank you.
About how much you are an introvert.
Mm.
And you wouldn't get that in if you're listening into this podcast, you think, well, an introvert, there's no way he's an introvert. Come on. But, you know, I often hear, you know, people say that introversion is a liability.
Mm.
And especially, you know, in the church. And when presenting things in the public eye, how have you actually used that as a strength in your leadership?
I'll tell you what, Susan Cain's book, Quiet, changed my life. So Myers-Briggs, I'm an INTJ, Enneagram, I'm a 5, wing 4.
Okay.
And I've always been more of a thinker, producer, very intentional. And I always found that was a liability as a senior pastor, because like senior pastors, they have to be like handshaking politicians in the foyer, right? And for years, I always thought of it as a liability. When I read that book, though, I realized, oh, no, I have to think about what do I have the ability to do that other lead pastors don't have? I have the ability to read way more nerdy books than the average lead pastor. I have the ability to video edit and be very intentional about church strategy. Hence, I write books on church governance theory or books on all sorts of stuff. Or, you know, so I can focus at my computer longer, so I can write pithier messages that are actually better for social media.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like that. So, you know, don't get me wrong. I am not as good at working the foyer, and I have to admit that. But actually, I'm not going to win by being the handshaking pastor. I'm going to win by using my strengths, not my weaknesses. Yeah. And, you know, ultimately, don't get me wrong, I never use your personality as an excuse. Okay, right. So I don't ever say, oh, I'm an introvert. It exhausts me to work a foyer, so I'm not going to do it. I have to do the work of the ministry. I have to be relational. I have to get out there. I have to learn how to turn it off and overcome it, but I also have to acknowledge it. And so really, if any, I would say introversion is actually the ability to concentrate for long hours on tedious processes.
Yeah, right.
That's great.
And so ultimately, because of that, so I just, I was just talking earlier about how I'm finishing a book called Church Bylaws and the Splits That Created Them. And it's all about how bylaw theory affects church health. And like, and I'm writing it because nobody else is going to write this silly book, you know? Yeah. And part of it is because it's too boring of a topic for most people to even bite off. But like, as an introvert, I'm like, oh, bring on the nerd fest, man. And if I can make it entertaining on top of that, you know, because, you know, if I can still make it fun, which is kind of the goal, is to take all this kind of stuff. So I hire a lot of extroverted pastors.
Yeah, that's great.
So like all of my campus pastors can work a, a phone like nobody else. And, you know, so it allows me to be a little bit more...
Sure.
Wizard of Oz-ish, if I could say it that way, behind the curtain, writing the scripts and writing the films and the and writing the sermons. But, you know, I think everybody just has to, like, I had to find some good lead pastors of some really dynamic churches who also were introverted.
Yeah.
And, you know, I found, like, Greg Surratt is an introvert, Andy Stanley's an introvert, you know, and I started realizing, oh, there's a lot of really good dynamic introverted pastors out there that I can learn from. And they also taught me how to, you know, surround myself with the type of leaders that can kind of balance it. And so, again, I you can't use it as an excuse. You got to learn how to operate in both environments. But it's it's like being left-handed versus right-handed. You can't live in denial of the fact that you're left-handed in a right-handed world. And so, and unfortunately, introversion has always been frowned upon in the American leadership culture.
Yeah,
for the last 50 years, but it's switching now. It's actually, the pendulum is swinging, and I think it's gonna. At the end of the day, I'm not better. I'm just different.
Right.
So it's celebrating that.
Well, and I think there's a lot of, you know, a lot of 18-year-olds listen to this. A lot of our students on campus, you can take personality tests at any time, right? Learn who you are, but until you start having life experiences, you might not necessarily know what you mean. And I think we see that happen a lot in that first job, right? When they're first in the spot, it's like, okay, I thought I liked this or I signed up for this, but I don't even know, maybe I do like the job, but I like it for different reasons. Yeah. What are some ways that people can practice self-discovery in these seasons? And so they can really kind of dial in on how they're wired.
Totally. Well, you know, it's kind of like personality tests as well as college, or like right now, you're learning. You don't want to learn information that becomes an excuse or a problem at your first job. Okay. So like, whenever I hear anybody in my church staff say, well, I'm an Enneagram blah, so I don't do, and I'm like, oh, no. You just use it as an excuse.
Right.
Don't ever use it as an excuse. Or I have a degree in this, therefore I know how to do youth ministry. And I'm, oh, don't assume you know anything about youth ministry, because actually, so we always have like a standard definition that I rip off from my friend Matt Keller, whose sons come here, on, shout out to Will.
Yep.
But Matt would always say, teachability is the ability to relearn that which you already know.
Wow.
No, and so constantly keeping humility, especially in that first job, learning about it before you immediately start sharing your opinions about it. And the same thing is true about yourself, your own sense of gifting. There were things in me actually, you know what's funny? To come back to that curator story, I thought I was a terrible speaker. And actually, in college, I was. I could not stand in front of a single person and speak worth dirt. I mean, at all.
Yeah, wow.
But I was a musician. I could perform in front of any group, but I couldn't speak. And yet my mentor was like, dude, you got some insight. You need to share that. And I'm like, no, I'm a behind the scenes guy. And he's like, no, you need to share that. And they would constantly drag me up onto stage. I mean, I, honest to God, would not have become a speaker. I would have been like Moses. Oh, I can't speak. I'm underqualified. Yeah. But the problem is that you don't know you. And it takes, you know how it is. Yep. Every year you get older and you discover yourself a little bit more. Mm-hmm. And so I always tell young leaders, don't assume you even know yourself.
Right.
Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, so we always talk about internal call versus external call. Internal call, what you think you're called to do. External call, what other people say you are called to do. And so you're like, no, but I'm a great singer. Mm-hmm. Well, do other people think you're a great singer? You know, it's kind of like this one guy was like, he preached for like an hour and a half every Sunday. And he's like, yeah, but I'm a great preacher. I have the gift of preaching. Okay, maybe you do, but do your people have the gift of listening, right?
Yeah.
Like, you don't confuse your internal call for your external call. And so I'm always telling young people, hey, make sure you allow time for your external call to develop. Right. Don't assume that just because you think you're called to be a brilliant fill in the blank, that God thinks that's how he created you.
Got it.
So you just got to wait until your external call confirms your internal call and then live there for 10 years.
Yeah.
And then you'll actually be hot on the trail of God's calling. Otherwise, you're being premature in what you think you are.
That's so good. And we, I mean, at SEU, I mean, that's what we talk about all the time. It's all about divine design. And building that discipline of self-awareness so, man, you can be in tune with the way God wired you so that you can celebrate that in the way he's going to use you.
Yep.
And that can change, always can change.
It will.
And if you're not in a position to be aware, you're going to miss great opportunity.
It's true.
That's, wow. That's
it's
so
true.
Powerful.
I
love
true.
That. Well, we're going to move into our fire round. Ooh. And we always, in this fire round, just ask a few quick questions. And we'll probably ask a little bit about everything we've discussed this afternoon on this podcast. I want to, and again, and you do so well at man, answering with your gut. So we want that again on this. So let's just get some practical, applicable pieces of advice for our listeners today. So, Michael, you fire away.
Okay. So we talked, you touched on this for a second. We talked a lot about the frying, but it's been kind of eating at me. Okay. Church bylaws.
Yeah.
You're studying them. You're writing them. You say there's one bylaw, one type of bylaw. What is it that matters?
Well,
nerd out with me for
it. Yeah. Okay. Well, just absorb this stat. Very, very rarely does a church ever grow without its founding pastor intact. In fact, most churches go into a permanent plateau between year 17 and year 21. And after year 17, they grow by 1% a year, and it's almost all transfer growth. So almost all growth after the founding pastor is transfer growth, not conversion growth.
Wow.
And so missiologists have been asking the question, why? Why is that? What is it that causes churches to grow with their founding pastors intact? And they found that year 17 and 21 is when founding pastors tend to resign. And then the church goes into a power vacuum. And then a new person wins the job by promising to maintain the most ministries, not by being a great leader.
Wow.
And so the exceptions to the rule, there's 1% of churches continue to grow after the founder is gone. And the two things that make the exception are the non-founder is there for 6 to 10 years. In other words, they learn all the political institutions and then learn how to finally, you know, change them. Yeah. And then the second thing is they have bylaws that enable those changes. And so, you know, as churches age, they go from taking risks in the beginning, because you have no assets to even protect, so you'll take all sorts of risks, right? To the whole focus of the board is to protect the assets and the legacy.
Right. Yeah.
And so the church moves from man, movement, machinery, monument.
Wow.
And you can always tell what phase the church is in based on what they talk about. What, like when you ask the question, what are you called to? Like if you go to the average church member, well, I'm called to, you know, like people saying, I'm called to Dr. Engel. And I actually, just so you know, to compliment you, several of your staff, when I've talked to them, That's what they said. They just said, all I know is Dr. Engel is like the most gifted and consistent leader I've ever been able to work with. And that's a good sign because that again, man, movement, machine, monument, mm-hmm. when everybody's saying, well, I'm called to the history of SEU, or you know, like, yeah. or I'm called wow. to the programs,
yeah,
like I'm called, that's the machinery. Mm-hmm. And so you can always tell what phase in its life cycle based on that. And so a good set of bylaws, decision making, mm-hmm. Will kind of keep the fountain of youth cranking.
Love it.
Yeah, that's so huge. Good. Governance is huge, man. Governance is huge. There's no doubt about it.
We could do a whole nother podcast on governance, and we may need to because there's a lot I want to jump into that.
That's, yeah, yeah, for sure.
Sorry for
sure.
all the 18-year-olds that don't care about that, and they just tuned out on the word governance, but like, we're having fun over here. I know John didn't tune out when he said governance. Right, that's for sure. That's good.
Right. Let me ask you this question. What is the piece of advice you'd give to college students who are right now in the midst of all that we're going through are just kind of feeling lost and overwhelmed and aren't sure what next steps to take?
Yeah.
What do you do?
Yeah. Well, we talked about internal call versus external call.
Yep.
If you have a sense of your internal call, like as a college student, I knew I was good at music, mm-hmm. at writing, and then I got a heart for ministry after I gave my life to Christ. Well, that was my internal call. Put yourself into a position where you can get an external call.
Wow.
In other words, don't just get stuck in your own little world and wait for the world to come and mentor you. Mm-hmm. Mentoring is not something you are entitled to. It is right. something you have to earn.
Yeah.
Wow.
And so, like, I had a guy, people come up to me all the time and they're like, would you mentor me? Well, and I generally have to say, well, I have barely time to mentor my staff, right?
Yeah.
Well, one kid goes, he walked away discouraged because I told him no. I literally couldn't, okay? I want to tell everybody yes, right? But I had to tell him no. Well, 3 weeks later, he came up to me and he goes, hey, Pastor, can I just mow your lawn for free this summer? And I'm like, huh? And I'm like, what do you mean? Like, can I just come over to your house and mow? You pay someone to mow your lawn, right? Do you think I could just come over and mow it for free, save you some money? And I'm like, maybe. I'm like, would you do a good job? And then he goes, no, just, I promise you, if you don't like it, you can come out, critique it, and I'll pay you. Just like, he was like, and I'm like, oh, okay. Well, he would show up to mow my lawn, and I'd see him out there sweating on the hot mm-hmm. day, and then I'd go out there and offer him a glass of water, and, and you know, we kind of hit it off, and then I'd see him the next week, and then I gave him refrigerator privileges.
Yeah.
And then he'd come in, he's like, hey, Pastor, I was going to either do this ministry or that ministry. What do you think? And I'd say, oh, I'll do this one. And then he'd walk up, thanks, Pastor. And then the next week, he'd come in. And then by the end of the summer, that dude got more mentoring than half my staff.
Yes.
He tricked me into mentoring him.
That's awesome.
And I realized I actually learned what I needed to do to get mentored.
Wow.
Find dynamic people
mm-hmm.
and serve them.
Yeah.
Lift their burdens. And so just that's what young leaders need to do. Find people to serve, mm-hmm. lift their burdens. That guy got more of my time than my staff did. And and ultimately you earn the right to get that external call.
Oh, that's so good. Wow. That's good. You have one more question, Michael?
Yes. Okay. So you obviously are in a lot of books. We talked about those on the front. If there's what's kind of your most recent good book? Like you're like, hey, this is the book I'm recommending to everybody right now.
Oh, yeah, for sure. I would recommend my two comedy books. So I write comedic books on spirituality because I just want people to laugh. You know, mm-hmm. most people, it's like I want people to be entertained and then provoked, okay? So with thoughts, okay? Mm-hmm. So Broken Escalators is on the 10 myths of promotion and happiness. Mm-hmm. And so what I did is I found all of the statistical predictors of happiness. And then I bring it, all this psychological research, and then I bring it through the lens of scripture with absurd storytelling.
Yeah.
So it's all just, so I figure at least if people don't like the research, they'll at least like the crazy stories. Right. So Broken Escalators is probably, and it's actually great for young leaders who, for them to understand exactly how God forms their calling, because it's all about what happens when you don't feel like you're getting the opportunities you want.
Yeah.
Like when you think you're gifted at fill in the blank, but it's not happening for mm-hmm. you. What? Yeah. Why does God purposely break our escalator, and what does He want us to learn in the meantime? And mm-hmm. so that's the first one. And then Pharisectomy is another book I wrote. Pharisectomy,
which I actually got for free at Catalyst one year.
No.
I love it. Yes, it's still on my bookshelf.
For
yeah,
real?
Pharisectomy.
Oh my
yes.
gosh. Yeah.
Yes.
So it's yeah. how to remove your inner Pharisee and other religiously transmitted diseases.
Yes.
and I wrote it for young leaders who are frustrated. They're entering churches that feel old and dysfunctional. Mm-hmm. And how do you be a healthy transformational agent without getting toxic?
Yeah.
And so for those of you who are maybe cynical about church and you're deconstructing church right now, this is a book on how to reconstruct it in a life-giving way. Basically, how to fall back in love, laugh your way back in love with the bride of Christ, warts and all. Mm. And so if you're a young leader out there and you're kind of just in a frustrating leadership situation, it's really describing me taking over my first church
yeah.
and dealing with constant frustrating opinions yeah. about everything.
Yeah.
And so in some ways, it'll give you this endurance and love for mm-hmm. God's church. And at the end of the day, that's what God promotes, because He loves yeah. His bride.
Love it.
Yeah, so good. Peter, thank you so mm-hmm. much, man. This has been a powerful conversation. And what I love about you is you reek with relational authenticity, and that is so powerful. And man, thank you for the insights and the wisdom today.
Mm, absolutely. Thank you for yeah. having me.
Love it. Love it. Well, hey, if you want to stay up to date with Peter, you can follow him on Instagram and Twitter at PeterHawes1. PeterHawes1. And if you are loving what you're listening to on YouTube right now, go ahead and hit that like button, hit that follow button so you can get more leadership content right to your YouTube feed. You can also check us out on Instagram at Kent_Engel or on Twitter at Kent Engel. And you can also get leadership content right to your inbox every single week. Sign up for the Framework Leadership newsletter at kentengel.com. Thank you so much for listening to Framework Leadership today.
Hey, take care, everybody.